If you don't like to be pushed around and underpaid and overcharged and excluded and disrespected and manipulated and controlled, if you don't like those things, you should be interested in this evening's exchange and presentation. 81% of the American people polled over a year ago said yes to the question, do you think America's in decline? And 75% said that corporations had too much control over their lives. And 61% said the two major parties are failing. So we're dealing here with a remarkable consensus. If you ask the American people about power, concentrated power, unaccountable power, commercial power, political power, if you ask them whether they're conservative or liberal and how they feel on certain discrete hot-button issues like pro-choice, pro-life, questions dealing with gun control, they will split quite decisively one way or the other. You ask them about power, and there's a different perception, because who hasn't been ripped off by a credit card company? Charges, gouging interest, penalties, late fees. Who hasn't had to pay $30 or more for a bounced check, which costs the bank $1.50, including covering fraudulent checks, according to the Federal Reserve? I mean, who hasn't been exposed to the frustrations of trying to get your bill corrected with your telephone company or your cell phone company? These are the daily irritations that add up. And they add up not just in money, they add up in a feeling of powerlessness. You call and they put you on hold, or they say, you know, press one, press two, press three. There was a time I used to be working late at night years ago, and if I wanted classical music, I dialed United Airlines. So these are the daily frustrations, but there are big frustrations as well. And we're supposed to be a society that has democratic characteristics to it. To be sure, it's a republic, but it's supposed to be a republic that fosters democratic decision-making. And ask yourself, did we have a lot to say about the criminal invasion of Iraq by Bush and Cheney? Did we have something to say about the invasion? Did we have a little to say about the invasion? Did we have nothing to say about the invasion? A, B, C, D. Pick it. See? We basically had nothing to say. Because, number one, the president failed us. He did not follow the Constitution, which means that only Congress can declare war. The Congress failed us because Congress abdicated its responsibility under the Constitution and gave it to Bush. The media failed us because they rolled over with these retired Pentagon people by their side on television and parroted the misconceptions, lies, falsehoods about weapons of mass destruction and Saddam Hussein being a threat to the United States and connected with Al-Qaeda and 9/11, all of these demonstrably false and so much part of the historical record of correction that they're really not debatable. Even his own people admitted it, like Richard Clark, who's his anti-terrorist advisor in the White House. And the Democratic Party failed us because they were not the opposition party. They rolled over in the Congress as well and didn't challenge Bush and Cheney. So where did that leave us? We weren't represented by a major political party. We didn't get the truth and other viewpoints on the mass media, unless you're listening to Democracy Now! Or Amy Goodman or reading Nation magazine or Progressive magazine. We weren't represented by the Congress, which in effect torpedoed the critical war declaration authority that our founding fathers thought was one of the most important aspects of the Constitution, which they did not want one person in the White House to plunge our country into war. And we certainly weren't represented by our own citizen groups, because they didn't have much money, they didn't have many organizers, And although at the time, in March 2003, when the invasion occurred, there were over 300 ex-generals, retired admirals, colonels, former heads of the NSA, CIA retired, ambassadors retired, who spoke out against the war. But they had no infrastructure, they didn't have millions of dollars to get them on the mass media the way Bush and Cheney could get on. And therefore, even though in an unprecedented opposition by the very establishment, diplomatic, military, national security, retired people under both parties going back years when they were in the government, they spoke out, but it just fizzled. It was an op-ed here, it was a letter to the editor there. Nobody was able to supply the money to organize them so they could double their number, triple their number. We wouldn't have been in Iraq. You just can't, day after day, even if you're president of the United States, face down leading military officials, leading national security officials, leading diplomats from both parties, retired, free to speak, with knowledge and judgment. And so, now who was pushing for it? Who really liked it? Well, you've heard of people sacrificing their lives for their country, right? Okay. Have you ever heard of a corporation sacrificing its life for our country? It doesn't even sound right, does it? Can you imagine DuPont saying, for the love of my country, I, DuPont, am going to sacrifice my existence in fighting the rush to war. I will lose contracts, I will lose profits, I will have to shut down plants, but I believe that this war is unconstitutional. It's going to kill a lot of Americans, injure a lot of Americans, kill enormously larger number of Iraqis, over a million, by the way, blow apart a country, increase the opposition to us, bring Al-Qaeda into Iraq, which never was there, and on and on. You'd never hear that. No, these corporations are making money off war. You remember Dwight Eisenhower in his farewell address. Some of you have read about it in history, 1960. The most memorable part of that address was when he warned the American people about the military-industrial complex. That's Lockheed Martin, for example, Boeing, Raytheon, and the connections with the Pentagon, where a lot of retired Pentagon people go into high corporate positions, and it's the merry-go-round after they retire, and back and forth, and then they go back into the Pentagon, the corporate executives, and so on. So there is a way that corporations and their puppets in government, and we do have a corporate government now, there is not a single agency or department in Washington, D.C. that is not overwhelmingly controlled by corporate power from the outside, thousands of lobbyists, and their own appointees in key government positions like Secretary of the Treasury, Secretary of Defense, and so on. So we do have a corporate government. It's a corporate state. It is the antithesis of a democratic society. Government has to be arm's length. It's there to represent us, not corporate power over us. So we grow up in elementary school and high school, and we learn about American history, a little bit about government, how laws passed, etc., a little bit about the economy. But we don't really learn about the facts as much as what the systems are supposed to be like. So when you learn about how a law is made, it's kind of a formalistic ritual. The bill is put in a hopper, it's assigned to a committee, it's heard by the committee, it starts moving to the floor, etc. Well, that's a very antiseptic and mythical way about how things really operate. Because the key, for example, is who writes the law? Are it the corporate lawyers connected with senators that they finance in terms of their campaigns? Is that part of your civics book? That those laws are not written by the staff or the members of Congress? Overwhelmingly, they're written by the vested interests who provide them with the very language, provide them with the speeches to praise the legislation, for example.